we're victims of our own success because these novel drugs are so good and so much better than anything we had before that the standard model of how clinical trials are run creates situations where two drugs are tested against each other that are known to be very, very different.
I really thought that I was part of a really civilized, compassionate society. But what I felt I was going through was something very different to that. I felt like it was like some 21st century equivalent of medieval torture.
In my view, there are problems that come from the physician, from the patient, and also from the protocol.
In the past, we were used to give very, very toxic drug or some ineffective treatment that there was some minimal evidence of activity. But now things are changing. And suddenly, there are several advances, not just one. It's targeted therapies, immunotherapies, even some new chemotherapies that change the picture.
Okay. Good morning, everyone.
What is the benefit for melanoma patients being treated with these new agents? For targeted agents, we know that the median overall survival time ranges between 15 and 18 months. In comparison to cytostatic drugs, which is in the range of 8 to 10 months median survival time. But it's not only the median survival time, which I think is important. I think we are also interested in long-time benefit in patients who are surviving 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and some of them even 10 years.
This I wanted to tell you, not only in Romania, people were not speaking about clinical trial, but there are also doctors in Western European countries which are not speaking. And then, okay, they said there are not issue stage three in that moment. There are not standard therapy for you at the hand in this moment. But there were.
I didn't want to back down with that news, you only have 6 months to live. I couldn't believe it because I couldn't see myself lying in this coffin. Very strange, but I couldn't see this picture. So I thought, no, there's something coming, so I have to push on. And then I started to go on Google, started Googling, and I came across this story about Patricia Garcia Peto doing a trial in France with some new drug for melanoma. Every 5 minutes we were talking on the phone. And that was the first time that somebody really told me there's hope, there's a chance, okay, it's probably lethal. But you can prolong your life for a very good time, and there are a lot of new procedures coming on and new drugs. So then I got hope again, and I got my fighting spirit back.
The clinical trial actually is the only treatment available to them. Now, it was never supposed to be like that. A clinical trial is supposed to be exactly that, a trial of something that may or may not be better than the alternative. This notion of equipoise, you know, we don't know whether this medicine is going to be better or not, so we're going to try it. But for some significant groups of patients, that actually isn't the case anymore, because the only treatment available to them is medication, drugs that are in trial. So to deny them access to a clinical trial isn't just to deny them the opportunity to take part in research, it's actually to deny them the opportunity to have a cure. So we're in a very difficult situation now where the rules designed for research may well be perfectly reasonable, but this is no longer merely research, it has become treatment.
the first barrier that is mentioned by all the patients basically is to get accepted into a clinical trial, just because of the specific design of the trial that may not meet the current patient health, basically, or the former patient treatment, which is one of the issues that is really annoying and really limiting a lot the patient participation.
He's not eligible for trials because obviously he was 13 at the time. If we hadn't had a very good, very well-known oncologist on our doorstep, I don't think he'd be here. I know he wouldn't be here.
What I consider true cruelty to patients is having exclusion and inclusion criteria that very few people can meet to get to this promising treatment in a trial.
I mean, I was very lucky because I had it on an expanded access program back in 2010. Normally, I would have been expected to die that year, but I'm still here in 2014. So I'm very happy, but I feel much guilt because I have made friends on the internet with people who have my disease and they're not getting access to this drug. And I look at them and their young mothers or their young fathers, they seem so much more worthwhile than me. And yet I was the lucky one to survive and they're not being given that opportunity.
I think there are a number of imponderables. One is inequality, so that we know, for example, that even within Europe, there is a huge disparity in the level of service available for people living in some countries as compared with others. Even within the relatively rich continent of Europe, that's a very big and painful disparity.
There's a lot of, yes, tick box EU-wide, but each country then goes away from the conference and just does what they've always been doing in their country and doesn't change. And I think a truly sort of European-wide approach, unified approach is needed.
Well, I was accepted onto the trial. Unfortunately, it was a 2-to-1 randomized trial. That means for every 2 people that obtain the nivolumab, 1 will be allocated to a standard chemotherapy arm. In this case, it was DTIC, which is dacarbazine. I was devastated to find that I had been allocated to the standard chemotherapy arm. This is the very drug that wasn't of any help to me and made me feel ill.
There's no benefit to anybody to have a randomization or no crossover. Let's say that you were given a choice of chemo, a promising therapy, and nothing else. So that happened recently, and what good is that for anybody? So we have a chemo that doesn't work, and then we have the promising drug. What does that prove?
I mean, by this time, I was 4 months into a diagnosis, prognosis of 9 months to live. Was I prepared to commit myself to a drug that I knew was going to be of no use to me? No, I wasn't, so I withdrew from the trial. Unfortunately, my local oncologist felt that I was adversely affecting trial statistics and did say in a letter that if he was going to refer to me to Southampton for the re-challenge of ipilimumab trial, which obviously I was very keen to be part of, that I needed to give them some reassurance that I would accept whatever drug I was allocated to. All I could do was reassure him that I would do that. But that caused me a lot of problems because I felt that it was totally unethical to put me in that position.
Ipilimumab is not a cure. It's not a cure. I still have disease. I am still going to die. But it's given me this, for four infusions, it's given me this life. And, you know, those four infusions were over 12 weeks. And, you know, the first one was in 2010. And I have such a good life.
I want my voice to be heard. I want clinical trial designers, drug companies, I want everybody to know how hard it is to know there are drugs out there and you can't get them. I'd like them to try and explain it to my children, because I find it very difficult.
One of the questions when I get invited to meetings where trials are discussed and there are trials designed that I, from my perspective, think are unethical and that no patient should ever have to go on such a design, I always ask the designers and the people sitting in the room, would you go on this trial if you were the patient? Or would you send your wife or your husband? Or what about your child on this trial? And so far, no one ever said yes.
From Cancer Institute from Amsterdam, this was her luck, they recommend Zelborav. But it was too late for a clinical trial. She was in a very bad condition, so practically she was not corresponding in that moment to the eligibility criteria. Well, Zelborav, but Zelborav was costing almost 9,000 euros per month.
Pharmaceutical companies develop drugs in order to make money for them. That's the driving force behind it. And we have seen in the recent years the drugs, the novel drugs of melanoma that work, are predominantly coming from industry. So we need industry to keep doing that, because otherwise there will be no novel drugs that we need. So I think in order to keep the innovation going, we need the right incentives. So there must be some money to be made.
Pharma, again, it's a business. If we didn't have pharma, we wouldn't have any drugs.
So I do think it is important to be aware of this connection between, yes, we want realistic prices, but it still has to be relevant to the companies we want to work for us. That does not mean that the current prices are justified, and I don't think they are. Development costs of trial are a big problem.
I see a lot of waste everywhere in how things are run, and too many people and too much money going to the wrong things. So I think efficiency could possibly help.
The regulators traditionally spoke to companies and advised them on trial design and what they needed to do and what they needed to prove to get things through the regulation system. But what happened is that evidence that was produced as a result of that didn't then meet the requirements for the reimbursement system. And sometimes they perhaps be at odds. And the group that I'm working with at the Centre for the Advancement of Sustainable Medical Innovation is the sustainable bit, is we recognise that the healthcare systems have limited resources. So what we're trying to support the companies to do is become much more efficient with the way they're developing drugs. So if we can see if we can get the final cost down. And that's efficient not only in that the costs associated with running those big trials, but also in the time taken to get to market. So we're hoping it's a quid pro quo approach, that we actually look at the system costs as well.
Takes into consideration quality of life. So
we got really lucky in the sense that for the two treatments, both in France and in United States, we could have money from colleague, work colleague of Patricia, my wife, really send money, provided a purchase, a flight ticket to go to the US, for instance. And then she received help from Melanoma International to be there, you know, for lodging, for food, not for medical expenses, of course.
In Netherlands and also in Romania, they are not covering the cost of the treatment itself. And some people were very good people, in fact, good intended. They said, let her go. And I said to them, I cannot let her go. She even didn't have the chance to try a treatment. I cannot let her go. And I was revolted, and but also very determined. And we went back in Bucharest with her in a very bad condition, in a hospital mobile bed. And there, something miraculous happened. Her colleagues from University of Bucharest made a humanitarian campaign for her. And in 3 months, she had 100,000 euros for 10 months of Zelborav. And she is living because of this today.
What I think makes it even worse is that there are innovative models out there that are actually discussed for quite some time. Regulators and reimbursers meet each other at conferences discussing alternative designs. And these designs would actually be much fairer on the patient because they do not require these horrendous large trials with arms that are so startlingly different from the beginning.
I mean, essentially, it's saying we won't require quite so much evidence before this medicine can be used. So we'll still require some, but what we will do then is give this conditional approval for the medicine to be used and much more monitoring then of that medicine in use with real patients. So that if a problem emerges that wasn't clear at the start, we will pick it up quickly and we can stop the use of the medicine. So it brings it forward quite significantly, reduces the time it takes to get approval. But if it works properly, it protects patients by monitoring the drug in use in the real world.
In the standard approaches to licensing, you have a series of steps that a drug has to go through. And the steps are sequential. So first of all, you have the scientific discovery, then you have the trials that have to be done, and then you get to the regulators, the regulator has to make a decision, then you get to the healthcare system, and the healthcare system has to make a decision, and then you get into practice. Whereas in the adaptive approaches, the different sectors sit down and actually help design the best way for that drug to get through all those systems and hopefully break down the silos so things move much more, transition much more rapidly through them. And it's an enabling system rather than the series of hurdles that have to be got through.
I think the fundamental aspect of adaptive licensing pathways is really the interaction between all the key stakeholders. If you look at the proposals, you don't see any new revolutionary, I don't know, clinical trial design or licensing approach or different standard of evidence. No, it's not about that. It's fully within the current legal framework and, if you want, methodological approaches that are being developed. But it is really about having early interaction and early agreement as much as possible about what evidence needs to be gathered for all stakeholders to make their decisions.
I think adaptive licensing is a very promising concept. But there are a number of key bits that need to be got right if it isn't to result in people being exposed to unacceptable risk. So in theory, it could enable medicines to be available quicker for people to benefit and perhaps even for the quality of data to improve because you're trying out the medicine in real life rather than in the artificial clinical trial context. So there's a lot of pluses. But there is a risk involved as well, which I suspect is why progress on this has been quite slow, because we need to deal with the risks that are generated by that approach first.
To push the case on. There are also lots
we want early access and we want to learn about the drugs. The regulators want to know how does the drug work, how efficient is a drug and how safe is a drug. And the reimbursers want to know how good is it really, so which price is going to be justified at the end. So I think it's a very attractive model addressing many key issues.
regulators think that they're very good surrogates for patients, but is that true? We don't know. So it's very useful always to sort of have this reality check and ask real patients, are we interpreting correctly the benefits and risks of drugs?
I understand that there has to be regulations controlling drugs. Clinical trials are there to test the efficacy and safety of a drug. But I'm dying. If you know you're dying, you're willing to take risks. If that smacks of desperation, I think that's to deny me my feelings of altruism for future patients. It's not just about me. I have a vested interest in finding a cure, but not necessarily for me. If I don't live long enough for that, I would like to be part of that journey.
I have a disease that is going to kill me. I can sit and watch it grow and watch it kill me. Or I can take a chance and maybe try an untried and tested drug. And that may still kill me, or my disease may still kill me, but also there might be some benefit in prolonging my life, or I might even be cured. But if I do nothing, I die, or I have the chance of maybe having some hope that I might get some benefit of the drug. To me, personally, I know I would be giving up a really good quality of life if I took a new drug and it harmed me, but I think that I probably should, because I know I'm going to die otherwise, and it's the only hope of having a future is to take a risk.
I can be treated terribly, terribly well, and then you have the whole of your tumour.
The rules of what is acceptable risk are made by healthy individuals, but not by patients with metastatic melanoma. So I know that from our very own personal experience with my husband, that I know that our approach changed entirely, but there's actually research done into that. And there is a study done for the Genetic Alliance, and they actually looked what patients really think about risk and what risk they're willing to take.
When we did this work with this citizens' jury of patients, they had a doctor who said to them, I'm a doctor, I signed the Hippocratic Oath, and I had to promise, more than anything else, to do no harm to my patients. I promised that as a doctor. So you can't ask me to prescribe you a medicine which I think is risky. To which the patient replied, stop patronising me. Let me decide. I need your help to decide, but if I decide to take a risky medicine, that absolves you of any responsibility for it. You don't need to worry. So there's a cultural shift here as much as anything else, really, I think, in people's views about patients' autonomy and their right to take risks with their own lives.
Before the drug is in a human, they should already be speaking with patient organizations about how it will eventually get into humans and then get hopefully approved one day. But patients can't be brought in at the last minute or late in the process. They need to be there almost next to the scientist who discovers the molecule. They should be part of the process.
You can have a gut feeling, but in order to really affect change, you have to be aware of the system and how it works to really be constructive. You need actually quite a bit of knowledge to be able to suggest what to change, because you go there and they ask you, so what is not working? And then you can say, oh, this is horrendous. And then they say, so what shall we do? And then patients often stand there like, I don't know, you tell me. And that is not working. So I think that patients have to recognize that they also have a responsibility for their own, for themselves, but also the group of their peers, that because of their own unique aspect, they can affect change that no one else can actually really drive.
Over 60,000 Europeans are diagnosed with melanoma each year, and we lose 20,000.
Basically, most of the physicians are not aware that it's completely insane to propose placebo versus the effective molecule to people who are currently dying. So that cannot be the case, that cannot be done anymore. But without any movement, without any organized movement, without any clear official association or foundation, you cannot do anything.
In the future, this involvement could be more and more. There could be, there are already a number of committees at the agency where patients are actually members of the committees. And also, when we discuss drug development with companies, we like to have more involvement of patients, so early input into the drug development decisions. We've already run some pilots together with payers, patients, healthcare professionals.
Just like the European Patients Academy. And what we're trying to do is to educate and train a lot of people. In the next 3 years, we want to...
I think that what really needs to be done is that patients show that they can be positive contributors to the medicine's development process in any disease area, and are considered part of the team that designs any process of development of a product or access to a product automatically. That it's not something where someone says, oh yeah, we have to invite a patient. It's like, it automatically happens because patients are now part of the process, part of the solution.
It has been an amazing experience, and I hope to see you again next year.